Welcome, everybody. This is the meeting for February 19th and occurring at a certain time, depending on your time zone on the planet. I'm Ross Colaci, Microsoft, and the first thing we want to do is welcome everybody here who hasn't been here before, who hasn't come to a meeting before. Would like to say hello.
Hi, I'm Ben Whiting. I'm from a company named Schweitzer Engineering Laboratories. Happy to be here.
Great to have you.
Hi, my name is Tom Hay. I am also from Schweitzer Engineering Laboratories. I'm part of Ben Whiting's team.
Great, pleasure. We've got Chris and Sylvan and on my upper left, we've got Trishunk and it looks to be Jacob, is that correct? And we've got Vaughn and Carolyn and Karen. This is Radu. I'm Ralph. I don't usually do this tour, and so this is my first time doing the moderation here. So we'll move on. Vote on CNAB the crab is our official auto-completion mascot. Exactly how should we do the vote, Carolyn? What do you propose?
Radu? Oh, sorry. Sorry. Ah, you look like Radu because
it's so funny. I do look like Radu. You're right.
I'm going to make you answer to that because you're sharing a room.
That's a big compliment.
because Butcher's not here and I know he had things he wanted to say, I was hoping we could delay it because otherwise it's not very nice.
Right.
Do we want to have a quick introduction as to what CNABBY the crab is for people who haven't paid attention?
Probably a good idea.
Oh, okay. So on everyone's phones, when you type CNAB, it's getting auto-completed to crab, which is really fun. And I'm seeing tweets and new people coming to the CNAB channel in Slack when they're asking questions. It's coming in as crab. And so I was saying, maybe we should have an unofficial little mascot called CNABBY the crab.
Right.
To embrace and welcome people who mistype and autocomplete CNAB as crab.
Got it.
Not as a new logo or anything, just as a
thing to do.
Nod to the pain that our autocompletion woe.
Right.
Yep.
And there are some, I think there are some examples on the Slack channel, if that's not mistaken, some fun examples. So, and Tom, if you want to, you can go look at that Slack channel and have a look at those. I do know that Butcher wanted to think clearly about what the purpose was for and stuff. I mean, it sounds fun and enjoyable to me. But if we want to just pass on to the next item and shelve that one for the next meeting, is that okay?
It was my agenda item, so yes.
All right. Okay, so I think we'll just say that we covered the issue to make sure we understood what it was, and then we will say that we're happy to wait one more meeting before we all vote on that, and that'll be enjoyable, I'm sure. The next item on the agenda after that is the CNAB registry spec. And Chris, your name is proudly displayed next to this agenda item.
I added this after chatting to Matt. We'd like to start writing down what CNAB's OCI does. So as most of you will know, we put the CNAB's OCI library in the CNAB organization recently. And it's under the Duffel Working Group. So it'll be owned by the same people who own the Duffel tool and CNABGO and everything there. What we'd like to do, though, is actually write down as part of the spec how we store bundles. So we've got an example implementation, but we'd like to make sure that we've actually codified it as part of the spec. And so I was wondering if anybody would be interested in picking that up and helping us work on that.
And I can also help on it.
Okay, cool.
We're using OCI bundles pretty heavily here, so love to chat about it.
Okay, cool. So maybe we can take this to the registry / security meeting on the off week. For those of you who don't know, there's a separate meeting. Every 2 weeks we have the community meeting, and then every other week we have the the security and registries meeting, which is more of a discussion around the working group stuff. So feel free to join.
I think the only outstanding question that I have about this about the registry spec is how we want to balance the work to propose the new media type to OCI, because that still hasn't happened yet.
I think you wrote a proposal, right? Or
I did write a proposal a couple of months ago, and I initially presented it to the OCI TOB, and then various pushback about, well, we should increment the versions, but the version is an integer and we don't want to rev a major version, and various minor nits happened and it just died out eventually. But I think it is definitely worth picking that discussion up again.
I agree. I'll certainly volunteer to participate in doing that. So put my name down for picking up the hammer and swinging it again.
Before we move forward, is anyone actually taking notes? Because I can't.
That would be a good thing.
I am taking notes. Can you not?
Oh, okay. Okay, my page doesn't refresh. Sorry, Carolyn.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've been typing with much flavor.
Thank you.
Okay, so as far as that item goes, Radu and I both agreed to help out and making sure that gets done, both in the specification realm and also in the approach to the media type with the OCI dist. Does that sound correct?
Yeah, that's great. Thanks. And it sounded like the guys from Datadog are also going to help out, so that's good.
Great. Fantastic.
Cool. Thanks, everyone.
And Chris, also thanks, Thomas and Ben. Thanks for mentioning the security, the alternating security meeting. If that's an area where you're interested in diving in, it's important to know that that meeting happens in an alternating fashion so that you can just jump in there without having to jump into the other things. So that's good to mention again. So the next issue, Radu, your name is next to CNAB security. So do you want to go ahead with that?
Yeah, the main thing that happened in the meantime since we've had the last CNAB security meeting was that we finally moved Signy, which is the CNAB security, the current CNAB security implementation, to CNABBY.io GitHub organization. So yay for that. We're looking for formal core maintainers because mostly it's been Trishank and I who contributed most of the code base there. But we actually need to put someone's name under owners and essentially have the same rules and the same methods when contributing to Signy as well. So if you're, even if you don't necessarily have experience with Go or with the CNAB security spec specifically, with life, I'd be more than happy to sit down and chat about the things that are happening in there and explain. And there are a bunch of things that we need to do there, mainly write documentation. And there are a bunch of low hanging fruits issues that I've opened in the last couple of weeks. So if anyone is interested in helping out, reach out on Slack, and I'm more than happy to pair and go through whatever is happening in that implementation. And then go ahead.
No, I was going to say the same thing. Yeah, happy to pair out with Radu and yeah, definitely walk through the code.
And then the only other thing that happened in the last week is there's an ongoing Notary V2 discussion, which aims to update Notary, which is the current implementation for signing OCI artifacts. And the discussion involves multiple people from registries and open source projects. And the discussion is very much ongoing, and it's still at the gathering requirements phase. And Trishank and Ralph and I have been chatting about actually going through the requirements and proposals and current proposals of Notary V2 and understand how it impacts, first of all, how it impacts CNAB security, and most importantly, also present some requirements that we've encountered, like moving signatures around, having air gap scenarios, being able to move signatures to air gap scenarios and things like that. So again, if you're interested in this discussion, feel free to reach out on Slack. We plan on opening an issue on the Notary V2 requirements project, and I'll link that in agenda and in chat. But essentially, we want to open an issue in that repository and essentially present out the things that we would like, or at least that need to happen for CNAB. So again, if you're interested in that, feel free to reach out. And that was it. Thank you.
There's one thing that I think that happened. Trishank, do you want to mention very quickly what happened with the Python project so that people are aware?
Oh, yeah. It only took like 6-7 years. I forget how long exactly, but finally.
Okay. Keep it positive, please. Don't go.
So the good news is, it's been accepted. Python is going to be the first, as far as I can tell, the first open source programming language repository to use stuff, right? And that's a good validation of the technology, I think.
That's pretty cool. So and the more that people take steps doing that, the more they'll be able to demonstrate the value of it. And I think that's a great thing.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Facebook is paying for it, just so people know. They're funding the effort.
Again, I want you to remain. No, that's fine. That's a good thing.
This is a recorded
meeting, and so it's very important that I assure everybody that I'm joking, because Lord knows I work for a company that people can also make jokes about. So that said, the next item is a question. When we bump the spec 1.0.1, what is expected to be a hybrid for a tool, maybe an older version of a tool? There's not a name for this particular agenda item. Who would like to start with this question?
Yeah, this was my question. I was just curious, let's say, for example, that Duffel is still on saying supporting 1.0.0, and then Docker app makes a bundle that's 1.0.1 and publishes it to a registry, and then somebody tries to run it with Duffel. Like, what's the expected behavior? Have we defined that somewhere? Like, when there's just a patch difference in the spec, what are we expecting to happen? Do we just ignore the extra stuff? Do we have to have it match? We forward.
I think that's a really good question. We may not answer it specifically, but what I was just going to open up and check is because I know that Matt chose the versioning from WC3 or something like that. So maybe they have a definition of what the versions mean there that we're implicitly relying on.
And then the only other thing I want to add is we've been discussing on and off ever since 1.0 that any patch to any spec should come with implementation in at least a tool. And because we have a reference implementation, ideally it would be that, just to demonstrate that, yes, that patch actually is doing what it should be doing and it's implementable in our tools. So ideally, I would very much like to have any patch to CNAB come with an implementation, but I'm aware that's not always possible.
Yeah, but I mean, you can see how either there may be lag time or someone may just be on an older version of the tool. Like, that's going to happen. So we should have what people can expect it to be, right?
Yeah, I think the only thing that we can do, given that, people might be on older versions, is we clearly state which version of the tool, what version of the spec it is compliant with. I think that is the thing that we can do, right?
So I think in complex deployment scenarios, you're going to not have, there is no way all the versions of all the tools will be in line. That's just not going to happen. We should assume that is going to be normal rather than the anomaly. And if that's the case, then I think probably we pretty much need to have a statement of precisely what behavior should be expected when that happens in both directions. So if you think about, the question of like Helm or, the Helm 2, or kube control, right? There's the server version and the client version, and you're bouncing around against very different clusters that almost themselves. I mean, this is a very, very common scenario when you have multiple clusters, even if you have your own, you know, similar version of kubectl. So both directions, we probably should have a very coherent statement about what should be the expectation.
Yeah, I'm not saying that we need to understand what's the forward and backwards compatibility for, say, like patch and miner. Like, I just think as a group, we should start thinking about it and either split off and mm-hmm. talk about it as a separate smaller group for people who have strong feels or open up an issue and draw our swords. But yeah, I'm 100% with you, Ralph, that like it's going to happen and we need well-defined expectations so that people aren't left like, well, the tool just refuses to run.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm my particular, you know, stake in the ground is that I think that hard failures and clear statements are better than, you know, not doing things or trying to finesse things. In complex environments, finessing always finds the corner case, the edge case, very, very rapidly. And then it's hard to back out of. So that's my sort of architectural position. But I think we probably should have an issue open for it so that we can begin that threat process.
Thanks, Chris. Yeah, that is the right place for this to get
thumbs up.
Updated.
I thought we had a stronger statement about versioning, and then I found it, and I was like, oh, that's very, very loose. So yeah, thank you for catching that.
All right. So for now, I think we're good with that one. We've got a location. I don't know if there's an issue per se, but we should probably open one and target that location as requiring some elaboration and thought. Does that seem reasonable?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to the governance portion of our meeting. We've got a couple of bullets here, and it looks like Radu attached those. Do you want to
launch on those? I only attached the last one.
You only want to attach the last one. Who would like to start with factorizing and adding templates for governance description at organizational level?
Yeah, I added those points. So. Okay. While moving CNAB to OCI to the CNABBERS organization, I added a governance file and I can't remember which and I think we may have some template or even an organization governance, a top level governance, I don't know. It would be better. I think Radu, you had the same issue. While moving, Signy.
Yeah, Carolyn, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, let me talk to this for a second. So when I was looking at the governance doc for CNAB to OCI, I recognized that we, as a group, have had drift between what the document says, how we operate, like how we, for example, have a maintainer drop off of a project and things like that. I mean, it wasn't like a huge problem, but it is, you know, we say one thing, we do another. And so I left a couple comments on that. And then we realized like, well, actually like we've copy and paste this on every single repo and it doesn't match how we actually do things. So it would be a good idea perhaps to one, make a common template and keep that up to date in a community repo, which was kind of the intent of the community repo, is to have one place where we could just kind of keep those. And either one, link to those, or I don't know, get really good at copying from that. I'm not quite sure. But at the very least, we should update all the repos to match how we actually run the project. Because it doesn't match what we're really doing right now, and I think you seem to be happy with how we're running the project, so
Yeah, and you could argue that we can do the same thing for governance, contribution guidelines, maybe developer guidelines, and code of conduct references. Because I most of the time what we end up doing is having a paragraph for all or maybe for each in the README of the project. And maybe it's copied from somewhere and maybe it points to a file that is local to the repo. Ideally, we would have a standard paragraph that we would copy in every repo that would link to the CNABIO community repo. That, in my opinion, I think that would be the best thing to do.
yeah, linking to community, I think, would be easiest for us to maintain over time.
Take an action on that, as they say.
It sounds like Carolyn, Siva, and Radu have ideas about what we should do. Should we allocate time in this meeting to do it, or should we spin it out?
How do we wish to allocate that?
I think we, between the three of us, we can handle just, I can handle maybe taking the docs we have now as is and just getting them into community. And then as separate PRs, you know, as a group, we can just kind of discuss like the drift that's happened and make sure that we want to officially adopt what we're doing now. I think we do, but yeah. Okay. And then we can go through and link to them.
All right, then let's do that. Okay. That sounds good.
That sounds great. The other thing that I think Radu will feel this as well is that when we moved code, there was a bit of a process we had to follow to get code into the CNAB IO organization. So documenting that is something I can maybe pick up and do. Just explaining to people what process to follow and things you should think about. Radu's right, process is a bit strong, but you know, things like make sure your project has DCO, stuff like that. It just makes it.
All right, and then, so that's most of the government stuff. So I put in the next issue, which was re-upping 285. Glenn was unable to be here, Matt's not here, and I think the issue, if anybody hasn't looked at it recently, the issue is generally speaking starts out with the question of exactly what we can state in terms of this is my summary, and we'll move on because people aren't here. We'll actually start. We'll have a different meeting just for this this PR because it's been long running, and there are definitely many different ways to look at the problem. But fundamentally, it is a question of exactly how we might be able to address the CNAB runtime security concerns with respect to reducing the privileges that are required to execute the deployment activity. I'm going to call it, I'll keep it that at the high level, because in fact, there are probably six or seven or eight different ways that we could interpret those words. And so hence the length of the thread. So that one is going to require a little bit of work to understand, you know, what really can be done if you put your mind to it right now. Clarify a statement of what the concerns really are in which locations, and then see whether the solution is to merely have a creative implementation or whether it requires forward motion on the spec itself at some point to address the concerns. But without clarifying those kinds of things, I think it's very difficult for these particular issues to be all teased out. So the issue is a great one. There's nothing that it is absolutely great, which is why it's lingering, is because we need to focus. And I'm willing to take the lead on doing that. So that's why I put it in there. I just raised the issue to re-summarize it for the people in the meeting, and then we'll schedule something specifically on that so we can clarify the issues and figure out how to move forward on that, because it's a very good issue to discuss. Does anybody else have anything they want to say about that? I basically just wanted to summarize for everybody and say that we were going to have a special chat about it. Okay, that's for me. And then we've got some PR reviews. Vaughn, there's 331, is that right?
That's right, yeah. I can go through at least the first two really quickly. 331 is pretty straightforward. It's just updating the ID fields for all of our official schema. Now that we serve these schema JSON files from cnab.io, it's TLS only, so HTTPS only. So this just updates the IDs accordingly. 330 is an adjustment to the spec, ideally for the 1.1.0 milestone, to remove regex the negative lookup regex for, I think it was parameter and credential paths, which turns out to be incompatible with Golang libraries, especially CNAB Go. Yeah, Sylvan mentioned that. This is one solution for it, just to remove the pattern and place the burden on the implementation to adhere to the spec. So maybe give that PR some thought, check it out, and comment. And then the last line was just, Butcher still has like a handful of PRs that I think I still need to look at too, but just maybe check out the pull request queue and chime in on any that you're interested in.
And those are all worthwhile because, of course, that there is a general expectation that we are getting very close to these, to clear solutions and a label attached to them. And so you tend to, at least on my behalf, I get very excited looking forward to this. So it's important to have a look at all of these in a rational way, because I don't want my excitement to push any buttons before everybody has a chance to look. So give yourself a chance to look. And then we have some example. There's a line for example bundles in the duffel repo.
Oh yeah, yeah, I entered that as well. This was an ongoing. I don't remember. It was late last year. We had agreed.
There were some example issues, right?
Exactly. Yeah, we had agreed to deprecate the old DSLab/example bundles repo because they just fallen out of. They're just sitting there without being maintained. So right. we had agreed to select a subset of examples and bring them over to Duffel. So that 888 is the PR to do so. And once we get that in, I'd like to, there's another PR in the example repos, example bundles repo to have like a deprecation notice on top. So that's that.
I think when it comes to this PR, I think the main thing we should keep in mind is for the community to weigh in as to whether the examples are relevant for people outside of people working on Duffel specifically, right?
Yeah.
Carolyn?
Well, I'm gonna say no. I think that's the examples that we do more like in our talks and things like that, where are a lot more real world ones in the example ones, I think are, I don't know, no, not. I don't know. I mean, Vaughn, you would throw them like one. Oh my gosh. Maybe now that they're all maintained, but I don't know. I think you need like cloud access. You need all sorts of these things that are really hard to maintain in a separate agnostic repo. And like a useful bundle usually needs all sorts of goodies that, you know, like cloud resources to a specific provider or something like that in order to really resonate with someone and be useful and give them something they can copy and paste and use to make a new bundle for themselves.
Yeah, that's fair. I think maybe the only, or I think the positive benefits of these examples in the Duffel repo are just showing non-trivial. They happen to be, so Duffel uses a duffel.json. It's not exactly a bundle.json, but Duffel can create that bundle.json. Anyway, create non-trivial examples of what these bundles can look like. And it does add CI to validate example bundles if and when anybody wishes to add other examples to Duffel.
Yeah, I think in my opinion, there are two big benefits from having the examples there. One is we get to actually test building out bundles based on the current implementation for every PR in CI. And I think that's important. And the second one, which I'm not sure is there quite yet, is showing non-trivial features of the spec. And I think that's not there yet, right, in Duffel. But I would like to point someone to a place who asks, well, how do I use something? Like, how do I mount a credential as a file or as a an environment variable? Well, here's the example repos, and you can find the example that does that. I'm aware that we're not there yet, but given that in the future, if we want to add more examples, I think we should have a very clearly defined purpose of those example bundles.
It's entirely possible from, go ahead, Chris.
Well, I was just gonna say, I think we should be careful of who the audience is. So in Duffel, it's people who are writing tools maybe. That's very different to, you know, consumers at the end of the line. They'll have very different expectations of what to see in a bundle. So I think separating that out in my head is good.
I think the real problem here is that there are multiple tools and we have to figure out exactly what is the goal of the examples we're running against Duffel. And those have to be, at least seem to me, along the lines of what we're discussing, they seem to me to be linked to exercising the specification in a particular way. And with the intention that the people who want to look at those are people who are tools implementers rather than bundle implementers, by and large. Does that seem like a fair statement?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, so if that's the case, then we're probably doing the right thing, but we probably need to add specific guidance for that. Does anybody have should I take an item to write some of that guidance in a specific place? Radu, would you be so kind? Would you and Carolyn be so kind as to write in the notes, because I will not remember anything within 15 minutes that I took that action item. And if you could suggest a logical place, I'd be very grateful.
Vaughn, make them a GitHub issue and assign it to them.
There you go.
I can do that.
That would actually be perfect. Somebody, Vaughn, you seemed unduly enthusiastic about that when I. So there's that.
Yeah.
Okay. So then both Chris and Sylvan here are listed for CNAB to OCI call for maintainers. Is that correct?
Yeah, I'm stealing Radu's idea. I'll let Sylvan speak though, because he's actually maintaining.
Yes, so right now we all need two maintainers, Radu and I. So yeah, we're open for any maintainer interested in CNAB to OCI. And like Radu said, for Signy, we are available to run with you through the code. Just ask or ping us on Slack.
Just wanted to mention that Sylvan and I had lots of fun pairing to actually implementing stuff in CNAB to OCI, so we genuinely invite anyone interested in doing that to join in both CNAB to OCI and Signy.
Okay, so and one other little detail that is related to CNAB to OCI, it's a tremendously useful bit of code, and so one of the things that I've done recently is try and figure out what particular distributions of OCI dist have support for using CNAB to OCI. And so I've mentioned this in the Slack channel, but I'm chatting with GitHub to figure out what their implementation is so that yet one more thing could participate in this ecosystem that we're hoping to build.
Yeah, I think that's speaking to the action item of actually writing up the spec. That is one section that should be in the spec and should be regularly updated.
Right. I don't know if anybody knows, but Josh Litsky has a little scanning tool that he's written. I'll drop a link in the CNAB Slack just for the sake of discussion, but it basically does a little bit of operational testing against OCI distributions. And it may not be perfect, but I love it if people concerned could give an eyeball to it and see whether it's a helpful way to have us examine compatible OCI registries. And if not, if there's something we can do to improve it, that would be really cool. So I'll just get that in.
Ralph, sorry, I'm taking notes and I missed the first part. Are you talking about Josh's thing that he sent out or something?
Yeah. Else?
Okay.
Yes.
Great.
And I'll drop the link into the notes when I actually have more than my phone.
That's fine. No, I have the link. I was just making sure.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. Great.
Yeah.
Great. And I asked Josh to specifically run it against GitHub because his original list didn't have the GitHub registry in it. And so I have those results that Josh sent to me, and I'll forward those as well. Unless he already put them in, I don't know if he did. Okay.
Chris, did you have something to add on this discussion?
No, just that, yeah, that's definitely an area we need to tackle. We ran a bunch of tests. I don't know if we published the results against a bunch of different repo, but different registries and found issues across the board. So it turns out mixing OCI and Docker types does not go well for some registries. There's a lot of interesting discussions there, I think. I don't know if there's a clear answer.
Yeah, just for the record, if the registry supports lists or indexes, then adding CNAB to OCI support should be fairly doable in a short period of time. If they don't support OCI indexes or distribution lists, then that's a different story.
Yep, and if I remember correctly, CNAB to OCI as a library lets you choose what level of compatibility you'd like.
Yeah, you can fall back to using distribution lists if indexes are not supported by the registry.
Yeah.
Anyway, all of this is really important because sharing the work of everybody is probably one of the most critical things to enabling people to use the software, which is wonderful. So this is also something that I'd like to continue to drive forward with in whatever forms necessary so that it's very clear to all and sundry what registries support which features related to CNAB. I think that's an important thing. Okay, so Chris, you have the last entry here. We're what appears to be 42 minutes into the meeting. KubeCon EU.
Yes, so I wanted to know who will be there, if anybody. We can probably set up a meeting. Oh, that's great. So we should probably try to find some time to spend some time in person. We don't get to do that often, so that would be great. The other thing is I will be doing a talk on CNAB. I kept the abstract nice and generic. So if anybody has anything they'd like to show off, ping me and I'll put it in the talk.
That sounds great. I'd certainly love to all get together. It's a great opportunity to do it. So we should do that. Chris, are you going to be the social coordinator for that, or should somebody else be the social coordinator?
I think we could do both a social thing, maybe, and a, I don't know if we can book a meeting room like we've done previously as well. Maybe it'll be.
I'm using social coordinator as the, in the metaphorical tongue-in-cheek sense. Yes, we need somebody to go ahead and try and figure out a meeting. I guess we probably should fork a thread in the Slack and see who's going to be there and what times are good.
And just to point out, there'll probably also be meetings about Notary and OCI. So probably should attend those as well.
Yeah. And that's not a probably, that will happen because the personalities involved have decided that that is the meeting place that will occur. And it's for good reason, because it is a good place to get everybody together when it's otherwise difficult. So, yeah.
Yeah, in terms of who can do it, I don't know how to book a meeting room at KubeCon. I think people like Max have rooms pre-allocated, but we can take that.
I'll chat with Karen about, you know, what are the easiest. She probably has, 92% of all knowledge of ways and means. So I'll chat with her offline about what's the easiest way, easiest thing to do, and we'll report back to the Slack. So I can take that item. So you can type my name down again, Carolyn. Okay. Anybody else want to? We've got another 15 minutes just in case. We'd like to throw it open. Does anybody have any interest they'd like to pursue? Thomas or Ben, do you have anything you want to ask?
Right now, no. We're relatively new to the space, but we're really excited about this. And right now, we're kind of just digging through the open issues because you guys have kind of hit some of the things that we are a little concerned about and see how we can help out. One of the examples is like that example issue of like slimming down what's there and actually making sure that those are up to date. Because we just kind of ran through some of the examples when we were figuring out Duffel and Porter and stuff like that. And we realized some of these examples were a little confusing and then led us down the wrong paths, even though we've read the spec for CNABs.
Right.
So we're just kind of keeping an eye on what's going on, seeing how we can help out this community.
Oh, that's great. So because you're doing that and because through time, as you know, when we were talking about the process issues, for example, governance and so forth, and the way that there's been a slight shift in the connection between the words we wrote at one point and the behaviors that we currently have. Through time, there has been some slippage in those areas. And the first thing is, pretty much everybody here will feel a little guilty that we allowed you to run down the wrong path at all. So first of all, formal apology, at least on my behalf. Second of all, your input with respect to those that confusion as you go along is invaluable to us, right? So helping us understand where you were confused, what things are still problematic, would allow us to turn around and really fix the guidance and the entry point to that kind of information, such that you know the people behind you wouldn't be led astray at all, because we want everybody to find the right path for them.
Yeah, and we really appreciate that. And so far, the community has been really receptive and really quick to reply to questions. So that's great.
Yeah.
And for specifically for where we're coming from, me and Thomas, we are in a unique spot because sometimes the tool, we can't directly connect to a cloud provider. We need to do something with, we need access to the Docker socket to make like a CNAB work. So we are in a very, probably a minority of where the CNAB could go.
Uh-huh. But
we are very interested in what this functionality can provide for us.
Right, okay, so if you jump onto the Slack or file an issue or whatever about your particular situation, I can guarantee you that the beauty and difficulty of CNAB tooling is that it has an incredibly flexible application scope, and that is fantastic, but it's also a little confusing. So if you'd be willing to share some description of your user case and the problems that you see, at least right offhand, that would really help us not only help you understand whether the tooling matched what you were trying to do, but it also, in terms of our cases, it would be very helpful to help us figure out how to address those concerns going forward, for example, if we don't do it now.
Yeah, much appreciated.
Okay, great. That would do wonderful.
I just have to say that wanting to connect to Docker SOC is not a minority at all. It's just a underserved use case at the moment, and I apologize.
No, that's right.
Dublin Porter need to catch up with Docker app on that.
Yeah, and I actually remember talking to you like about 3 weeks ago about this in the Slack channel. So
we'll get there.
Yeah.
Yep. Great.
And like fantastic. We're willing to help out too. So.
Well, if that's great, if that's true, then the great thing to do is to find the right issue and jump on it and collaborate, or if the issue doesn't exist that matches your use case, please create it.
Perfect.
Yeah. I think there's one more agenda item that Jacob added in the meantime.
Oh, there we go. Go ahead, Jacob. Action field of top level in claims.
Yeah, so since we do have a few more minutes, this is a relatively small change to the claims object as it stands right now. But basically, I think right now they are in, so that if you have a claim, the action that was being executed by the claim is actually stored inside of the result field. I can't remember for sure. But basically, I just want to move that to the top level of the claim object. I feel like that makes sense. Would welcome thoughts on that. There are also two other issues, 327 and 329, that Butcher filed for us that would refactor things a little bit more. But any thoughts on action?
Hey, Jacob, I'm looking at it right now, and can you, here, wait, I'm going to share my screen. I probably do have thoughts, but I'm trying to catch up.
Yeah.
As long as we're here, we got each other. So is this what you're talking about right here?
Yes.
So on the claim itself, so what exactly is, actions like install, right?
Yes. Install, upgrade, custom action, etc.
Okay. So I think it was like a couple weeks ago, and I apologize because I haven't followed up on this, but I thought we were talking about taking all of result and actually like ripping it out and putting it as a separate item that wasn't stored inside of claim, but could be stored next to kink claim and stream separately. Is that still something we want to do?
Yes, for sure. This is very important for the scalability of like any CNAB implementation that's API driven.
Okay, so if we take results and we move it as like a sibling of claim, do you still want action on claim? Like it would be like last action, or does it still make sense to make that a top level field on claim after doing that?
I think the result would then embed a claim or have a pointer to a claim.
Yeah. But where would action go? That's what I'm trying to figure out. Just
the claim itself would contain the action field.
So the claim would then have, I'm going to use the word state, I'm sorry, but it would have state then. It wouldn't just be information about the bundle itself. It would be what was last performed on the bundle.
In my mind, a claim has always been the input, like part of the inputs that you need in order to execute an operation.
Okay.
So like you need the claim and you need the credentials in order to pass those to the invocation image, but that's it. If the action that you want to run is separate from the claim, then we would have to pass that as an additional parameter.
Okay, wait, I'm not arguing. I'm making sure I get this right, so I'm just taking notes. So claim itself, when we're passing it in to like the driver, would it be it's not the last thing that happened, which is what currently gets stored. It's not the last action, it's the forward action. It's the action that we're attempting to perform. So like if I'm doing an upgrade and I'm passing in the claim, you're going to see upgrade, and what gets persisted is upgrade. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't see install, which happened previously. Do I have that right?
Right, but there's nothing preventing a runtime from storing multiple claims for the same installation. So you could see a history of the actions that were performed against the installation.
Okay, so we would have almost like pairs then of results and claims.
Yes, which is why results might want to embed claims in certain implementations, but if you go the other way around, then it's a little bit awkward because then you're updating the claim object itself after having already passed it in. And at that point, you kind of like shouldn't really be mutating it again, probably.
Just for the record, that is fundamentally different from what a claim is supposed to be right now, which is just a record for the last installation.
Right. I think it's like so far it's been completely up to the implementation what they want to actually use claims for, though. Like because that is what gets passed around when you're running an operation, that's the way we've been tracking what actually has been done with an installation. So a user provides a claim to the API or for implementation, but this is pretty generic. The user provides a claim to a driver, and then the driver performs some action using that as input, and then has to update the claim and send it back to the user. So the claim is not immutable. It actually, because it contains the result, has to be changed, and then we have to trust that the user is like updating that result on their end so that when they pass a new claim the next time, it contains that information we sent back before.
Jacob, would you be interested in collaborating with us? Like, if I maybe lay out a stub of what I think you and I are both looking for with this, would you be willing to maybe go over the draft and then kind of hammer out what this could look like?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, I think maybe we just go over that if anyone else is interested, and then when we have something that sounds like matches what we've all been talking about for a couple weeks, we can submit a PR for everyone to review.
I'd be happy to pair on that with a smaller group. Would probably make sense.
Yeah, because I think we may need to hop on a Zoom once or twice just to figure out how we'd like to be using claims. Because, I mean, I agree, like, I've been having trouble using claims the way we have them working in the spec right now. So I would like to maybe not completely go back to the drawing board, but make sure that what we have works for us going forward.
Yeah.
My only mention here is whether it is still helpful to have an object that is immutable and is solely a reference to the result of the previous operation, in addition to having a result type that is mutable and it's used as an input for the current operation. I'm unsure as to whether we could just use claims for that, or we need a separate top level object in CNAB for that. And I don't have a strong opinion on it either, but I just want to point out that we might end up in a situation where we need claims to be immutable and just the record, as opposed to something that is mutable and is input for the current operation.
Do you feel like maybe we have an odd kind of mix because we have claim do double duty? One, because we have something that we register and store and persist at the end. And we also have something that we give to the driver at the beginning, and we pass off and we say, use this to actually, execute at runtime. And then we treat it as the same thing, but it actually is doing two different.
Yeah, from my perspective, this whole conversation feels like somebody trying to tease out overloading.
Initially, when we added claims, there was no outputs object. And when we were having the objects, output object inside the claim itself, was the point where we started having issues with how do we want claims to act when we mount them inside, right?
I have the same problem though with just the result as well though. Like anything related to state beyond just like.
Oh yeah.
I think he's just using that as an example.
Yeah, state as well.
Yeah. So that's what I mean. Like I feel like maybe claims are doing double duty and we use one thing to represent it. So that's why I'm hoping we can just split off.
But nonetheless, I think it probably, just this conversation alone probably indicates that sitting down and crashing through those with a smaller group of people and coming back with a proposal to sort of tease out the logical requirements here is probably worth doing. Sure sounds like it to me.
Yeah.
Roddy, you want to be in on that too?
Sure.
Okay. I know you said you didn't have feels, but I feel your feels.
Radu always has feels. So whenever Radu says he doesn't have feels, he has feels.
Okay, cool. All right, we'll figure out a time when we can get together.
It's when he doesn't say that he has feels that he actually doesn't have feels.
Okay.
Got me. He's. Yeah.
I know my Radu. Okay, so let's go back to the agenda. Has anybody added another thing? Because we are closing out. That was actually, at least for me, a very good area of conversation. And so I'm glad that, Jacob, you brought it up because it's a lingering issue, clearly, in several areas. So that's a good thing to do. Let's see. It's 9:59 on the West Coast, which means they are 1 minute shy. Thomas and Ben, thanks for listening in. I look forward to hearing from you in any number of capacities. Thanks everybody for being here. I think unless anybody objects, I will move to close out our February 19th meeting. Are there objections? Then we are free to go do other traumatic work.
Dinner for people in Europe.
That's right.
Hey.
Thanks.
Thanks, Vaughn.
Thanks.